Hey there, folks. My name is Addison. If I were to ask you who the lover of the Russian queen was, what would your first answer be? Some more questions for you. Who was Russia's greatest love machine? Who was the kind of teacher women would desire? That's right, folks. Today we are talking about something amazing that also brings me great shame. We're talking about motherfucking Rasputin. So if you're like me, your only exposure to this guy is through the numerous attempts you've made at getting over 10,000 points in his song on Just Dance 2. If you're like me, you've committed so much to that dance that you've ripped your pants twice doing the cool down-low move once at homecoming and once again at a birthday party. That's not made up, ask my friends. It was really funny the first time, and then also really funny the second time when I thought things would be different. Grigori Rasputin was a Russian mystic and self-proclaimed holy man who was friends with the family of Tsar Nicholas II and wielded considerable influence in late imperial Russia. He was born a peasant in Siberia and had a religious conversion when he was 28 and became described as a monk. He went on to meet the Tsar in 1905 and act as a healer for the Tsar's son, who suffered from hemophilia, a disorder which prevents the body from clotting blood. In 1912, the Tsar's son, Alexei, hurt his leg, which caused him to get a large hematoma, basically a bruise, that also infected him. When he was close to death, the Tsarina, or the Tsar's wife, sent a telegram to Rasputin asking him to pray for her son. He replied saying, "God has seen your tears and heard your prayers. Do not grieve. The little one will not die." And guess what? The kid didn't die. Even today, people can't exactly explain how he didn't die, and at the time, people thought it was a miracle that Rasputin had performed. The royal family appointed him a position working in the palace, and the Tsar even allowed him to change his name. He was seen as a powerful man, and many of his enemies began to accuse him of various crimes, even saying that he had an affair with the Tsarina, a clear sign that he was Russia's greatest love machine. He did look into various other religions, one being a form of spiritual Christianity called Kihilistai. However, he didn't go for it, since a big practice in that religion was a ritual to overcome sexual urges by giving in to them in large groups, which would spread the sin out among many individuals. So basically, Rasputin was not a fan of orgies. He spoke of salvation, saying that giving in to temptation was important to dispel the sin of vanity, which meant he could drink and clown around without issue. And that he did. His near-constant drunkenness and sexual promiscuity gave him a bad image with many people in the Russian Empire. However, during World War I, while the Tsar was off fighting, Rasputin became the Tsarina's personal confidant and advisor and convinced her to fill some political offices with his hand-picked candidates. As his negative reputation increased, people started getting ideas, as they so often do. They thought, hey, let's kill that guy. And since Boney M. had not yet released the song describing his strength, they didn't think it would be much trouble. In 1914, a woman attempted to assassinate Rasputin by stabbing him in the stomach. When it occurred, doctors didn't think he would survive. And yet, he did. 2 years later, Russian nobles concocted another plan to kill the man. Prince Yusupov invited Rasputin into his home and took him to the basement where he offered Rasputin cakes and tea laced with cyanide. At first, he didn't want to eat them, but then he did. He ate them, and he drank the tea, and guess what? He didn't die. Yusupov then offered Rasputin poisoned wine, of which he drank 3 glasses. And guess who was still kicking? Goddamn Rasputin. After 2.5 hours of waiting for the poison to kick in, Yusupov grabbed a revolver and told Rasputin he better say a prayer before shooting him once in the chest. Sadly, that was Rasputin's final prayer. Oh wait, no. He still didn't die! This goddamn king of a man was poisoned, then poisoned some more, then shot, and was also stabbed 2 years before, and he didn't die! The other conspirators left the crime scene, and Yusupov went back to the basement to make sure Rasputin was dead. So naturally, Rasputin leapt up and attacked the guy, causing him to run away. Rasputin followed him into the palace courtyard before being shot by another conspirator and collapsing in a snowbank. The group then simply wrapped up his body and threw it over a bridge. His body was later found underneath the ice. I think the moral of today's story is 2 important things. 1, some men are really hard to kill, and therefore you shouldn't attempt to murder anyone, because it might be a lot more work than you bargained for. And 2, if you're going to do the Russian low kick dance, wear flexible shorts. You'll regret it otherwise.